I am Dorothy Thompson, and I have been asked to introduce Sands of Sorrow because I have recently returned from visiting the scenes of the picture you are about to see. Of course, the impression left on my mind by these wretched casualties of political change is much more distressing than the film. For no film can convey the icy winds from Mount Hermon as they blow upon slazy, floorless tents in Syria, or the rains that turn dwellings into mud holes in the rainy season in Lebanon, nor the defeated feeling even of those who are trying to help. But this film tells part of a story that until now has hardly been told at all outside the Arab world.
A suffering people, the Palestine Arab refugees, are struggling for survival. 750,000 displaced human beings are dependent upon charity for their very existence. This is one of dozens of camps in which these refugees huddle in squalor. All are overcrowded, jammed with men, women, and children who have no place to go, no place except the desert, no home other than a tent or cave. No food other than that which is donated to them. In these camps of misery live the scores of thousands whose native land was for centuries Palestine. Then the tragedy of war descended on that holy land and made them wanderers. Today they have no alternative but to camp in the sands which surround their former country and wait. The seemingly endless wait for humanitarian assistance which the fortunate peoples of the world have always given generously to those less fortunate in times of human disaster. Children and older men and women are the chief sufferers. Distribution time is the only bright ray in their routine existence. The contents of one truck will not help many, that's true, just emergencies on the neediest cases. This is an open-air distribution conducted by the Egyptian army, which now controls and administers the territory south of Palestine, known as the Gaza Strip. In this narrow area of sand along the Mediterranean, there are 250,000 refugees herded into a space only 22 miles long and 5 miles wide. Like other Arab countries, Egypt is hard-pressed to accommodate this great mass of newcomers. The country grows barely enough food for her own population of 20 million. There are no dwellings available in her overcrowded cities to house these former citizens of Palestine. Despite the fact that Egypt has already contributed more than $8 million as her share to their relief, this money has enabled only temporary alleviation of their distress. It has been spent on clothes, blankets, food, and on the administration of a stricken area from which there is no economic return. The time for distribution depends on the arrival of fresh supplies, never a certainty in this period of Near East turmoil. Such supplies are never ample enough to go around, and the refugees know their turn may not come for a long while. Whatever they draw, they take back to their families. A blanket, soap, a little rice, the means to keep warm, wash and ward off disease, to keep alive until the time for the next distribution. One can't blame them for impatience, but desperation breeds impatience. Long months of waiting has driven their morale to its lowest ebb. There is opportunity for little except to live from day to day in the hope that soon, somewhere, the way will open for permanent resettlement and lasting security. Their traditional Arab pride rebels against the acceptance of handouts, against living on a dole at the mercy of someone else's generosity. They would prefer to work and earn their living, as they have done in happier years before, and as their families did before them for centuries. But there is no work in a desert refugee camp, and no opportunity for self-support. Food, enough food, is their ever-present problem. The United Nations sends truckloads of flour and basic food essentials, but what they send is not enough, so great is the need. The town of Gaza is now the railhead for supplies forwarded from Egypt. As soon as supplies are unloaded from ships and trains, trucks take them to warehouses located in key refugee relief centers to await careful allocation. In the 2 years before the United Nations solely assumed the task of caring for these displaced people, relief distribution was organized and administered by such world-famed organizations as the International Red Cross and the American Friends Service Committee, working in cooperation with various United Nations branches such as UNICEF, UNESCO, and others. The fact that 750,000 of these Arab refugees are alive today is due in great part to their early awareness of the extent of this tragedy and their great efforts to cope with the problem. Because of a high birth rate, the number of mouths to be fed increases by more than 100 daily. Registration cards listing all family statistics are carefully checked. With food short, duplication must be avoided. Many refugees, like the dignified man in the black jacket, are college-educated graduates of American and Arab universities in Cairo and Beirut. This man is a mudir, once in better days the mayor of his town. Impartiality is the absolute rule. His issue of flour, rice, margarine, and beans is no larger than that for the humblest refugee. He gets no meat, for there is none. Daily rations total only 1,400 calories per person, 300 less than is needed to sustain life over a long period. UN relief workers know that the arrival of fresh milk powder supplied by UNICEF may mean the difference between life and death to the refugees, especially the children. It is milk that has helped prevent the death rate of a few months ago, an average of 120 deaths a night, from going even higher. The powder comes packed in sterilized barrels and must be transported thousands of miles from the United States and Great Britain to points which UN officials select as areas of greatest need. Once in the mixing shed, the milk powder must be stirred until it is dissolved in boiled, disease-free water. Even water is a problem. In many camps, there is but one well to fill the needs of 10,000 people. Lacking other dietary requirements for healthy bodies, the children need far more milk than it is now possible to give them. Malnutrition has sapped their strength for too long. Their faces reflect the care and worry which they see reflected in the faces of the older refugees. They are old beyond their years. Flies must be kept away from the milk. In this part of the world, flies spread deadly diseases, start epidemics, which might spread from camp to camp in a matter of hours. In every camp, the children wait as eagerly for their milk ration as American children do for ice cream. And they have first call. Many of these children are too young to recall ever having had enough to eat. The days when their parents owned enough cows and goats to provide them with all the fresh milk they could drink. Milk is their mainstay. Just as a pot of hot broth is a luxury to the older folks, in this land where a hot meal is a rarity owing to the almost complete lack of firewood. Even the simple tasks of housekeeping, such as mending, must be done in the open.